Merci. Moi, j'ai rencontré Gilles pour la première fois en 2006 et je l'ai connu comme directeur du M2, du Master 2 et comme professeur. J'étais très, très contente une dizaine d'années après quand on a commencé à travailler ensemble. C'était vraiment un honneur, un plaisir et un honneur, surtout parce que j'ai connu une autre partie de Gilles. À part qu'être un professeur et un mathématicien, il a un côté humain et il fait des blagues extraordinaires, ça, il faut le dire. Et je la considérais toujours, alors d'abord j'avais pensé de dire que je la considérais toujours comme une Bible vivante de probabilité, mais après j'ai décidé de changer et de dire que je le considère comme une Ferrari vivante, une Ferrari de probabilité. Je trouve que c'est mieux d'être une Ferrari plutôt qu'une Bible, mais c'est à voir. Et voilà, et comme petite blague, je vais vous dire peut-être, je vais vous parler quelques secondes en plus du côté italien de Gilles. Moi, je suis italienne et j'ai ajouté juste il y a 10 minutes troisième slide pour parler du côté italien de Gilles. Je ne sais pas si tout le monde sait que Gilles, il adore la Nutella et il aime aussi beaucoup le cinéma italien des années 70. En particulier, il aime beaucoup, là, je pense qu'on la voit un peu, c'est une actrice italienne, Ornella Muti. Et voilà, peut-être je vous dis quelque chose qui vous savez pas de Gilles. Voilà, je pense que ça vaut la peine de commencer à parler un peu de maths. I'm going to switch to English for this part. Okay, I'm going to present a paper that has a nice, basically, a quick and nice story at the beginning, behind. So it's a paper where, together again with Martino and Gilles, we solved via a power series a fractional Riccati equation. And now you might wonder why we were interested in this and what is the connection with finance. And a third question of yours might be why rough is not so tough. So at the beginning, this paper has had rough is not so tough as initial part of the title. Then we decided to change because the title was going to be maybe too rough. So the connection between this fractional Riccati equation and roughness is maybe known since 2 days because Matteo Rosenbaum in his presentation said something about this paper. And you will see, I will tell you which is the connection between a rough stochastic volatility model and a fractional Riccati equation. So what I'm going to go through today is a quick warm-up to explain you the origin of our problem. And then I will show you the solution to this fractional Riccati equation. And I will then also present you one possible scheme that we call the hybrid to solve the problem in some practical cases which are of interest to finance. So apart from, again, the Nutella side, so let me tell you that since the papers written by not just one paper, but many papers written by Gaderal, Thibault Gesson, and Mathieu, there has been an increasing interest in stochastic volatility models which show a rough behavior. Rough means that the volatility, the stochastic driver in the volatility is the fractional Brownian motion or a specific representation for the fractional Brownian motion. And if you are curious, I think that this website that I'm showing with the mouse, this Google website on specifically RAF volatility is quite nice because it's well maintained and it gives you many information since the birth of RAF volatility models to today, basically. So, behind this idea, so the idea of using the fractional random motion as a stochastic driver for the volatility was not new. It was used by many other authors. The first two, I think, are Comte and Renault in 1998. Of course, you know that Comte is related to Gilles, his wife. So I hope I will have also the opportunity to meet her sooner or later in Italy. And okay, so what I'm going to present you is one way of solving this family of fractional Likert equation that come from the characteristic function of the log price. So the connection between the fractional Likert equation and RAF stochastic volatility models is the characteristic function. So just to be, I added one slide to show maybe a quick look at the Aston model on top, equation one, equations one, and the RAF version of Aston model on the bottom here. So as you see, just to fix the ideas, the equation for the spot price is exactly the same. What changes is the second equation, the equation for the instantaneous volatility. Well, you see, apart from this integral, dt integral, I invite you to have a look so to compare the two stochastic integrals, where on top you see eta zeta square root of v dB, and here in equation two in the bottom, you see the same times a multiplication by this kernel t minus s power alpha minus one. Thanks to the presence of this kernel, the idea of Mathieu and Gaveral and many other co-authors was the one of modeling a RAF behavior in the trajectories for the volatility. So this was a starting point. Then, of course, they developed a whole stream of nice and brilliant literature on this. And so in particular, the connection between alpha and the Hurst index of a fractional Banyan motion is this one. So alpha is equal to h plus one over two. And they were interested in cases when h is smaller than 0.5. So since the first papers from the 90s were dealing with a H which was greater than 0.5. So the new paradigm since the RAF volatility literature started is associated to an H which is smaller than 0.5, so a RAF behavior. And just to focus a little bit, H close to 0.1, so really RAF trajectory. So the volatility has RAF paths. Okay, so here's the starting point, and here is the slide where you see the model for, so when you see the spot price S and the famous until now fractional Likert equation. So I added basically there are three columns in this table, and we focus today on the first one because we will use the results in this paper by Omar and Mathieu, who proved that the characteristic function of the log spot price of X can be computed in this way. So you see that you need to compute the exponential of phi one at time t, capital T, the maturity, plus v zero, the initial volatility value, times phi two at capital T. Okay, so now the question is, apart from noticing that there's a U1, which is the frequency parameter in the Fourier transform, so where do we see phi one and phi two? You have to come here and notice that Basically, in order to compute the characteristic function in this case, in a rough Heston model, you need to find a triplet. Why a triplet? Because you need psi, this function psi, that has to be integrated in a classical way to obtain phi 1. Phi 1 is the first exponent here. And you also need psi in order to compute its fractional integral and find phi 2. So, in order to be able to compute explicitly the characteristic function in the rough Heston model, you need a triplet, psi, phi 1, and phi 2. The point is the difficulty, so our interest was in the fact that psi is solution to a fractional Riccati equation. So, Riccati because of this square, of course, fractional y, because the order of derivation here is alpha. And is potentially a fractional, okay? So up to our knowledge, when we started working on this, it was 2017-18, if I remember well. So, and we invited Gilles to Padova, and we told him that there was this fractional Riccati equation still to be solved, up to our knowledge. Apart from one possible numerical way of solving it, which was the Adams method. And it was nice, as always, because he said, okay, show me the equation. Well, okay, so show me the precise definition of d alpha and I of order, whatever, alpha, beta. And then in a few minutes he said, I think I have an idea on how to solve this. And basically after this, the story, if you want to imagine a movie, the story is Gilles computing pages and pages of computation and myself and Martino running after him, basically. That's the story of this paper. So just to be precise, notice that the three parameters in the fractional Riccati equation are nu, mu, and lambda. And these, of course, depend on the coefficient in the Fourier transform and on model parameters. Okay, so from now on, we will focus on this equation 3. This is our target, solving the fractional Riccati in case when the initial condition, which is set here, has u equal to 0. Okay, so in today's talk, today's menu is alpha in 0, 1, which corresponds to h, the Hurst index lower than 0, 5, and u, this u here, so a null initial condition. Just to tell you something, to spoiler you a little bit, what I'm going to do is present a solution which is of a power series solution. Then I'm going to show you just some technical, nice, but quite technical results on the convergence domain for this series. And then I will tell you what we thought that could be done in order to find a solution in an extended domain. So a domain larger with respect to the convergence domain of the power series. Okay, so this is just to recall you visually, at least, how the fractional integral and fractional derivative of a function f are defined. And what is crucial, what was the starting point? So what I think gave the starting idea to Gilles were these equations 4 and 5. Because if you just check for a few seconds, equation 4, this one, tells us that the fractional derivative of order alpha of this monomial t power r is what? A quotient of gamma function times again a monomial power r minus alpha, okay? Derivative of order alpha of t alpha minus 1 is equal to 0, while derivative of order alpha of a constant function is not equal to 0, as one might maybe expect, or maybe not, and it is equal to this constant times t minus alpha. So the idea is that since we want to solve the equation derivative order alpha of psi equal to lambda psi square plus mu psi plus mu, Gilles, I think, okay, and we thought a posteriori, a good idea could be try to represent psi as a series like this one, so that if you apply the derivative of order alpha, you still remain in the class of power functions, and you can try to identify the terms, so to find the coefficients, AK, these coefficients in the series. This is what we did, and we succeeded in doing so. So we tested this specific representation for the function psi. Psi equal to the sum over k of coefficients AK times T power K alpha. Of course, before I have to admit that we made a first test with a different power, with a different exponent, and this didn't work. So the second attempt was working, and we were happy, of course. So this slide is a slide of course, the most important part is at the bottom, because you see that we were able to identify the terms in the series. Why? Not why, how? So avoiding the trivial cases, which is behind this assumption, we proceeded in this way. First of all, we computed psi square via this convolution. Given psi square, so on one end, what you can do is use the power series decomposition and apply the derivative of order alpha to the power series. This is what is done here, this line. So you take the power series, you apply derivative of fractional order alpha, and you find this series here. Okay. So on one side you have this, on the other side you know that psi has to solve the fractional Riccati. So psi is also solution to this by definition, to this equation by definition. And then it remains, of course, to identify the terms. If you do so, you immediately find that A0 is equal to zero. In particular, A1 is equal to nu divided by gamma alpha plus one. And if you continue, you find ricursively all the coefficients AK in the power series decomposition. So you see that AK plus one is explicitly written as a function of AK and AK squared, so the convolution of AK. Okay. So we tested a power series decomposition for the function psi, and we succeeded in finding a successful decomposition for psi. Of course, as soon as you have a series decomposition, you have on one end to truncate. If you want to explicitly compute psi, you have to stop at a certain point, because you cannot compute an infinite sum. Of course, this is trivial. And before really computing the function psi, what you have to do is be sure that the convergence radius for your power series is, of course, not equal to zero. So we remember here, because we are going to use this in twice or three times later. So the well-known Cauchy-Adamard formula for the convergence radius of a series. And let me stress that the reasoning behind the birth of the hybrid method is in this sentence, because we had to be careful in that the power series has a specific convergence radius, but we wanted to compute the solution psi also maybe outside this convergence domain. And so we had to conceive an ad hoc numerical procedure, which we call the hybrid method. Okay, so a first check that we did, there were pages of computations behind, but we were satisfied at the end, because this first formula, equation six, gives an important message. The message is the following: the convergence radius for the series is strictly positive. Okay, so we didn't work for nothing. So the effort was worth it. So our psi is greater than this value tau star. I have to stress that this value, this lower bound, is not is a conservative bound. This can also be seen in the numerical section. And there are more details in the paper, if you are curious. So we were able to compute this lower bound, but of course, we immediately understood that it was not an optimal bound, okay? So it's a conservative bound, but it was enough to be sure that the series converges on a domain which is not empty, of course. And we also computed an upper bound for the convergence radius that you find here if you're curious. Then, okay, so a first check was fine. It makes sense to use this power series specifically on the domain zero R psi, so on this circle, if you want. Now, the second step was, okay, I have at a certain point to stop when I compute, when I really want to compute psi numerically. So we decided, we did some numerical tests, in particular Gilles did many numerical tests, and we discovered that a posteriori, I will show you other criteria to choose our max, but a posteriori we decided that a good compromise could be selecting our max equal to 250. So quite huge, but yes, a good compromise between precision and computational time, okay? It doesn't require too much to compute the first 250 terms. Of course, as soon as you do this, but it shouldn't be me to tell you this because every person listening is much more expert than me in this. Of course, you have to be careful about the error you commit in truncating at a given threshold a series. And we were able to, I would say, explicitly find this bound for the error. The bound depends, of course, on R max alpha, and you see it also depends on tau star. Tau star was the upper bound for the convergence radius I showed you before in the previous slide. Okay, so now the message is we started from the Raff-Heston model, just to summarize. We started from the Raff-Heston model. We discovered that in the literature, in order to characterize in order to find the characteristic function, so pricing, what was missing was the solution to the Riccati equation. We tested a power series. We were lucky, so Gilles was very good, and we were at the end lucky to find the explicit power series representation. And then, so now we go back to our characteristic function, so to our triplet. Remember that in order to write the characteristic function, we need three elements. So psi, the solution to the Riccati, the integral of this solution that we can also write as I1, and a fractional integral of psi. So one, the first component, psi, is computed as this explicit representation. And of course, when you want to compute it via a computer, you just stop at R max, for example. For the second part, so the classical integral, you simply integrate and you find this explicit representation. And the same happens for the third, okay? Also, the fractional integral can be expressed in this way. Okay, so now we have all the three key ingredients to compute, to really compute the characteristic function. Practically speaking, then I'm going to go more into details on step one, two, and three. So you fix, and in the next slide, I'm going to tell you more on this. You fix R max, say 250. And you find the convergence radius associated to R max. I'm going to show you how this is defined in one slide. So maximum number of elements in the series is associated to a convergence radius. Then you check, because we need the triplet at one specific time capital T. So you fix a sort of security threshold, theta, that you multiply by the convergence radius. Okay, why? Because you need to check whether you need the triplet at capital T, and capital T is in the convergence domain or outside. So if you are lucky and capital T is in the convergence domain, then you can smile as is smiling, and you can use the power series, and you're done. If this is not the case, so if your capital T, which happens of course in all the financial applications, is outside the convergence domain, the power series is not enough. So you're not so happy, and you have to proceed to step three and four. So today I'm going only to present you the idea behind the hybrid, so step three, the hybrid method. In the paper, you will also find some an additional refinement, so a refinement made via the Richardson-Rhomberg extrapolation. Okay, so more details on step one. As I told you, at the end, we decided that it was quite fine and satisfactory to fix R max equal to 250, but if you end, not bad, and if you fix R max equal to 250, this is the formula we used for the convergence radius. So starting from the Cauchy-Adamard formula, you take the last coefficient in the series with this exponent, and you find an approximation of the convergence radius. We also discovered an alternative using the coefficients involved in the computation in the second component of the triplet, but maybe this is too much to say today. So there are alternatives to compute the convergence radius, but say that we fix 250 terms in the series, and associated to this, we get a convergence radius. The threshold is fixed to 0.9. And so what happened is that you can safely use the power series truncated on this domain. So from 0 to 0.9 and the convergence radius, okay? One, this convergence radius, or the other. Just remember that capital R is a convergence radius. If you need the solution psi outside the convergence domain, then of course you need to do something else. And this is what happens here. So again, if you are in a safe, in a, let's say that, let's use these words, if you are in a comfort zone, where the comfort zone is meaning that you are inside the convergence disk, then it's fine. You can compute the triplet, the three series in the triplet, truncating up the first 250 terms. If it's not the case, then you have to go out of your comfort zone. And what we conceived is a specific numerical, a specific hybrid method. So the idea is the following. The idea is working until the threshold, so until as much as you can, you use the power series. And then, as soon as you exit your comfort zone, you, in any case, exploit what you did before. How? So, this is a good idea about how to construct this. There's one element that you're missing, because I didn't tell you yet this part. So, the crucial equation is this one. Okay, until now, psi was just the solution to the Riccati equation. Okay, now instead of looking at derivative order alpha of psi, one can do can reason in an opposite way and consider the integral, the fractional integral. If you do so, basically what happens is that you get this equation. So instead of d alpha psi, you get the psi equal to something else, where of course you see mu and lambda, okay? As soon as you see this equation, you might understand immediately what was our idea. So in the convergence disk, you can use the power series. And then you can discretize, you can basically exploit this idea where I have to tell you something more. So starting from this equation, now we go just one step backward. So we discretize the domain where we want to work, so from zero to capital T. And at a certain point, if you discretize zero capital T, you will find an index k0, which is exactly corresponding to tk0 just before the threshold, okay, the barrier, say. And tk0 plus one is just outside. So tk0 is inside the domain of convergence, tk0 plus one is outside. So remembering this, what you do is the following. You say that psi approximated at a value tk, tk outside the disk, the convergence domain, is approximated in this way. This is what? This is a discretization of this equation above, where we use, you see here, all the previous, all, because there's a sum, the previous values of psi computed also inside the disk, so with the correct, say, explicit and correct power series. Okay, so I still have 7 minutes. So as a test, so this is the idea, basically. The power series is explicit, but you have to truncate it. And in some cases, you can use it as it is. In other cases, you have to use the hybrid methodology. So to discretize the domain and to proceed as I showed you before. In some cases, of course, the power series is enough. In other cases, it is not enough. So first of all, we wanted to check whether the power series in itself is a good way of solving the problem, and then to test the hybrid method. So to do so, we stole the parameters from Eloche and Rosenbaum, because there was not so many literature dealing with this specific problem. So here in this table, you see the mapping from what? So on the first column, you see the Riccati parameters. The second column is the column relative to parameters in Eloche and Rosenbaum, which are here in this line. Our equation contains basically these coefficients. So I recall you that in our equation, for example, mu is equal to this quantity, which is different. It's a change of notation. It's nothing difficult, but this is just a table where there's a mapping between the different notation. And in the last column, the most important one, you see the numerical value for our Riccati, so lambda, mu, and nu, given parameters in the paper that I cited. Okay, notice that the dependence on the Fourier coefficient U1 is highlighted in red, and also notice that lambda, which is the parameter for psi square, is very, very small. We were aware of this, so it's okay, let me say that it is small, but not equal to zero. Okay, so it's not equal to zero. And so it's a real Riccati. Okay, so just to have the flavor of the convergence radius, this is the estimation of the upper bound for the convergence radius given by our theorem, which varies with U1, the Fourier parameter. And notice that, of course, as soon as U1 increases, the convergence radius decreases. So if you start with a U1 very small, you have a huge convergence convergence radius tau star, and this decreases and goes towards zero, okay? Luckily, we needed, in our real financial application, to use U1, the real part of U1 equal to 100. Okay, so If you test just the power series, you find for short maturity, of course. So if you select one capital T at which you want to find the psi, of course, a small one, so that you are sure you can just use the power series, you can find quickly, very quickly, this is the computational time, 200 microseconds, just for one maturity, say 3 days, for example. And so we were quite satisfied because the methodology was at least fast. Then what we did, we tested, we really went to do a financial application. So we consider a set of European call options with maturity from 1 day to 2 years, so more realistic, different strikes, and we computed the price by inverting the Fourier transform, so via what is known as Karmadan methodology, making vary the real part of U1 and with a fixed imaginary part of U1. U1 is the parameter in the Fourier transform. In case when you need to use the hybrid scheme, the hybrid method, because capital T is outside the disk, the convergence domain, we use the 128 discretization points. And the benchmark was Adam's method. Adam's method is a way to solve, is based on this equation, this one, the last important equation I showed you today. And it's a sort of discretizing this equation via trapezoids, and it's a, let's say a basic methodology which was working until which is still used to solve equations of this type. And what we found, I'm almost done. So in this table, which is not nice, I'm sorry, but I was not able to to displace the table. So different maturities. So every column has a different maturity. Every line, every row has a different strike. And in every rectangle, you find what? So the hybrid price, the price of the call option, so the price, our price, and Adam's price, the price obtained with the Adam's method. And in brackets, you find the computational time in milliseconds. What the star mean? So if you see one star, it means that there was a problem with the precision. Now I'm going to tell you more details on this. When you find two stars, it means that the price found by the Adam's method was possibly giving an arbitrage opportunity. So it was not a good price, okay? How did we compare the prices? I wrote something here. So we looked for the number of discretization steps in the Adam's method so that the difference in implied volatilities was lower than 0.01, okay? And we stopped after the number of discretization points equal to 150. Okay, so the conclusion is the following: for short maturities, our methodology as well as Adam's method is fast, but Adam's method in some cases has to deal with the potential arbitrage opportunity, which is not good. And our method for short maturity is, let's say, exact because we just use the power series. For long maturities, Adam's method is much requires a larger computational effort because it's longer to be used. Okay, so there are many more details, of course, in the paper, which is a long one. And let me finish with a picture that I took many years ago in Venice with Jill and Abbas when we were visiting the, and it was also a sunny day and a happy day back in the past. I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there any question in the room? I can't see the room, so
I see the room, but it's empty. The part of the room I see. Okay.
Yeah, Georgia. Yeah, just maybe a quick question. In the Amax, is the same Amax applied to the three? The three series or the other two need also about the same number of terms you have enough accuracy from your numerical test, or
that's sorry, I interrupted you.
No, let's go. Sorry.
Okay, sorry. No, yes. So the three terms in the triplet are represented all the three by a series. So at a certain point, you have to stop. And we decided also, because there were other components in the triplet, to stop at Rmax 250, which is big, let's say, but safe. Okay. See. So you stop in all the three cases.
Okay. So you're conservative. Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Is there any question in the room? Can somebody help me? I don't see the room.
I see the room, but I don't see. Of course, Gilles cannot ask questions because it's a paper. Better than me.
Yes, I think I have a question, but
no. So thank you for explaining these results. I just wanted to emphasize that I had the opportunity when I worked with Martino and Georgia to learn many things about the gamma function, because it's somewhat hidden in the computation for the convergence radius. But I learned the Kershaw inequality. Enfin, we learned. And I think that Georgia found it somewhere. I don't remember. Suddenly, we had a big shriek in her office, and she said, "Yes, I got it." And she had the Kershaw inequality, and the Kershaw inequality is a way to compare two close value of the gamma function, but it's not asymptotic. It's not asymptotic. And so that's the way all the inequality can be obtained. And okay. This make this work not only technical, but also fruitful. And I enjoyed it very much because because I learned many things about gamma function.
We learned much more. Much more.
So Denis, I think there are no more questions.
Yes, I have one. To compute your singular integrals, to approximate your singular integrals, instead of using the Euler scheme with a constant step size, did you try to use a technique that Gilles likes a lot? I mean, discretization with variable step size.
No.
But in particular, around the singular point. Mm.
No, we didn't test it, but I think it's this is so you're saying that maybe you take much more points around the singularity. Yeah. Yes. No, we didn't test it. And what someone also asked us was maybe to check the, what I'm asking to a student in these days is to check the stability and robustness with respect to the number of points you use for the hybrid scheme, to say how much outside the convergence disk the solution depends on what is inside. This is also has to be tested. See, there were many other tests we could do, and we didn't do it, but I think it's funny, even for a student, a bachelor or master student, because it's a nice math behind, not so much stochastic, so it's nice. Okay. Of course, I have to say it's nice, but it's really nice.